Hare Krishna. Conscience without intelligence is blunt. Intelligence without conscience is numb. Conscience and intelligence are two vital components of our inner defense mechanism. Conscience gives us a gut feeling of what is right and what is wrong. Conscience protects us from doing wrong by giving us feelings of guilt and remorse whenever we do anything wrong. So conscience acts at a level of deep, strong sense of emotions. Not sentimentality, but a deeper emotion. Intelligence serves the same purpose of telling us what is right and wrong by rational analysis. And in this way, conscience and intelligence both are part of our inner defense mechanism, which protect us from temptation and delusion. Now, while both of them can work together, but sometimes the two can get separated. Conscience without intelligence becomes blunt. Just as a blunt object cannot cut or penetrate anything, similarly, if we have an innate sense of right and wrong, but we do not have a rational analysis to explain why we consider something right or wrong, then we cannot convince others about it. Then we stay, we may ourselves stay on the right track, but we may not be able to explain to others why what we are doing is right and why some things are wrong. So the capacity to cut through others' misconceptions and give them a clear explanation is lost or is decreased when we have conscience but not intelligence. Now conversely, intelligence without conscience becomes numb. When we are numbed, then we don't feel anything. So that numbness may be because of disease, may be because of damage, may be because of desensitization, whatever. So sometimes with our intelligence, we might be able to provide a rational analysis of why something is wrong. And we may be able to present it brilliantly. But if our conscience is not active, then we won't ourselves feel that that a particular action is wrong or a particular action is should not be given up. It's bad. So we may be able to explain why it is bad, but we may not ourselves at all feel revolted or disgusted or dismayed on doing it ourselves or on seeing others do it. So we don't want to be judgmental, but we also need to have our feelings in harmony with reality. So now in the Bhagavad Gita at the start, Arjun has his conscience active by which he feels that I should not kill others. And therefore he says, how can I fight? I cannot fight against my relatives. But at the same time, he uses his intelligence, but his intelligence is based on the bodily conception. And therefore it is not well formed. And so we can say that Krishna points out to him that his feeling of right and wrong is misinformed. And that's why in 2.11 he says, Ashochan and Vashochastvam Pragyavadamscha Bhashase Gatasuna Gatasumscha Nanushochanti Panditaha. He says that actually, oh Krishna, Arjuna, you are speaking learned words, but your emotions are not in harmony with those learned words. You are lamenting for that which is not worthy of lamentation. So this mismatch between reason and emotion is what Krishna calls out. And by the end of the Bhagavad Gita, there is a brilliant harmony between intelligence and emotion that is established, where Arjun feels both pacified, indicating that his mind is calmed, and convinced, indicating that his reason that he feels pacified, indicating that his emotion, his conscience, his sense of right and wrong is satisfied, and his intelligence also is satisfied. Nashto moha smriti labdha tat prasadan maya achyuta sitosmi gata sandeha karishye vachanam tava. So the illusion has been dispelled, his intelligence, his recall, memory has been restored, and his doubts have been destroyed, and thus he becomes well situated. So the Bhagavad Gita's knowledge is not just intellectual, but it is spiritual and transformational, and thus it brings about a harmony of conscience and intelligence in protecting Arjun from illusion and reinforcing his inspiration and conviction to choose the right path. Thank you. Hare Krishna.